Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Shingles Audio Collection, Volume 6, by Robert Bevan, Drew Hayes, and R.E. Carr. Narrated by Cal Wembly and Cassandra Myles. Alien vs. Ass, Shingles, Book 31, Robert Bevan. 1.
Pump that gas, Dougie,
said Pa, his nervous gaze darting back and forth between me and the window of Mr. Henry's gas station. Mr. Henry was leaning back in his chair, either asleep or dead. I always assumed he was dead on account of Pa said if that's ever the case and the cops ain't shown up yet, we could go in and help ourselves to a couple of hot dogs. I ain't been right yet, but I was bound to be one of these days.
God damn it, boy, faster!
I'm pumping as fast as I can, I said, looking up at the numbers spinning upward on the pump. If we were intending to pay, we'd just gone past owing $12. Pa scoffed.
You call that pumping? Let me tell you something, boy. Do you remember when I jerked off that highway patrolman to get out of a speeding ticket last week?
Sure I do. You made me watch.
That was his request, son, not mine. But that don't mean you can't learn a lesson from it. Was I holding that cock like I was posing for a picture?
No.
Too fucking right I wasn't. I was pumping that shit hard and fast.
He gestured vigorously, pumping his hand toward and away from his mouth as he wagged his tongue back and forth. So you're saying I should do the same thing with the gas pump? I started stroking the hose up and down just like I remembered Pa doing to that cop's wiener.
Jesus Christ, Dougie, you look like a goddamn faggot. I swear to God, if you ain't done by the time Mr. Henry wakes up, I'm gonna drive off and leave your retarded ass here.
I'm doing my best, Pa. I can't pump no faster than...
Hey! Shouted Mr. Henry from the other side of the window. You stay right there!
Shit! Said Pa, turning on the truck engine.
I pulled the nozzle out and hung it up on the pump, but when I turned back around, I found myself in a cloud of exhaust as Pa's truck hightailed it out of the parking lot and onto Highway 59.
Bill, you son of a bitch!
Mr. Henry yelled after him as he stormed out of the shop and zipped up his pants.
You get back here and pay for that gas, or I'll God damn it!
He lowered his shaking fist and looked down at the large dark spot starting at his crotch and running down his left pant leg.
I done pissed myself again.
I tried to back away silently, hoping I could slip away before he saw me, but Pa's lingering exhaust fumes made me cough. Mr. Henry turned around and glared at me through the thick lenses of his horn-rimmed glasses. I was paralyzed with fear, but also fascination as I stared at the pee puddle expanding around his left shoe.
Well, well, well,
said Mr. Henry, tucking his thumbs under his suspenders.
What have we here? You're Bill Myers' boy, ain't you?
I nodded. My name's Dougie. Mr. Henry squinted at the gas pump.
Your daddy owes me $18.74 for that gas he just drove off with.
He's good for it, I assured him. He's due for a paycheck next time he gets a job.
Oh, I think you can work it off just fine. With your mouth.
You want me to sing for you? Mr. Henry laughed.
You're gonna do a lot more than sing, boy. You're gonna squeal like a sow with the cattle prod shoved up her twat.
I thought for a moment about what that might sound like, and I wasn't quite sure my voice had the range to pull it off. I reckon I can try. If I do good, is there any chance you'll throw in a hot dog? Mr. Henry's suspenders snapped against his chest as he let them go to unzip his pants.
Oh, believe me, son, you're gonna take all the wiener I can shove down your throat. I just hope you don't mind it tasting a little like piss.
That seemed like an unnecessarily honest self-critique of his wares, but I ain't had nothing to eat since yesterday when Pa and I finished off what was left of that dog he hit with his truck last week. That's awful generous of you, I said.
Shut your yapping,
Mr. Henry nodded toward the building.
You see that bucket of Boner Bob's all-purpose lube?
I followed his gaze and recognized the bucket immediately. Sure, Pa used that stuff to weatherproof our neighbor's deck, and I accidentally walked in on him in the bathroom one time while he was using it to weatherproof his wiener.
Go on over there and take the lid off the bucket.
That seemed easy enough. If these were the kinds of chores Mr. Henry needed done at the gas station, I hoped he'd consider taking me on full time. The lid came off easily. I held it up to him and smiled. Like this?
Yeah, yeah,
he said, reaching down the front of his pants.
That's real good. Now take off your shirt and rub a big handful of that all over your...
Something above him suddenly caught his attention.
Holy fucking shit!
A big silvery saucer-shaped object fell out of the sky and landed on Mr. Henry. It was as wide around as Pa's truck was from his front Confederate plate to the rubber testicles hanging from his trailer hitch. It stood about a foot off the ground on three spindly legs with little wheels on the ends. Mr. Henry lay motionless underneath it like a crushed beer can. Looking up, I saw two of the strangest-looking people I've ever seen in my life sitting under a transparent dome that covered the top of the saucer. Their skin was gray, and neither one of them had a follicle of hair sprouting from their big, bulbous heads. The smaller one stared curiously back at me with his huge, black eyes, but the bigger one hardly seemed to be aware they'd landed as he swigged back green liquid from a glass beaker. I ain't never met a foreigner before, so I was a little nervous about being an ambassador for my country. But it was my patriotic duty to give these folks a good first impression of America. So I raised my hand in greeting and spoke some words of foreign I'd picked up in school. Merci jihad hamburguesa. I wasn't exactly sure what that translated to, but it seemed to be enough to break the ice. The dome atop their vehicle dematerialized, and the two strange men stepped out. The bigger one stumbled out, staggered toward the building, then lifted his impressively large gray wiener to spray bluish-green urine on the wall. The smaller one stepped out much more gracefully and mimicked my hand gesture back at me. Glubnub. I didn't remember Glubnub from my foreign class. Maybe that was advanced foreign, or maybe... Of course! His name was Glubnub. Glubnub, I repeated, pointing to him. Then I pointed to myself. Dougie.
Dougie,
he repeated slowly. I was so excited. We were actually communicating. That's right, I said. I'm Dougie, and the guy you landed on is Mr. Henry. I pointed to Mr. Henry. Glubnub leaned his big head over to peer under the vehicle.
Frabble-glip-zoop!
He shrieked when he saw Mr. Henry still lying there motionless. The bigger one lowered the beaker from his mouth, stopped peeing on the wall, and turned around.
Zoob frabble frabble?
He looked under the vehicle, and his giant black eyes grew even larger.
Sklub fubble muck!
After quickly gulping down what green liquid remained in his beaker, he threw the beaker against the wall and hopped back into his vehicle. The transparent dome almost instantly rematerialized.
Glipzorb Nifron!
Glubnub shouted, but the bigger one didn't seem to even hear him as the vehicle's engine whirred to life. The landing gear retracted up into the lower body of the craft, which hung suspended in the air for a second before ascending into the sky and flying out of sight over the trees. Pa says foreign cars are shit, but I ain't never seen his Dodge do nothing like that. Glubnub seemed far less impressed. If I had to guess, based on the milky white liquid rolling down his cheeks from his big black eyes, I'd even go as far as to say he was sad. Was that your paw? I asked. Glubnub sniffled through his nostril slits.
Paw.
Don't you worry. My paw left me here, too. Let's go inside and get some hot dogs. Mr. Henry said I can have as many as I can eat.
Dougie. Hot dog.
I smiled at him. That's right, Glubnub. Hot dog. You're gonna love them. I took him by his three-fingered hand and led him inside. 2. Mr. Henry was far too critical of the food he served. By the time Glubnub and I were done, we'd eaten 3 hot dogs each, and I didn't taste even the slightest hint of pee on any of them. Glubnub seemed to really enjoy them, too, and he also seemed fascinated with all the other wonders America had to offer here in this gas station convenience store. He tore open bags of potato chips, pork rinds, and beef jerky, sampling each one before excitedly moving on to the next. He stopped when he reached the beer cooler, staring up in awe at the wall of Silver Coors Light cans. Perhaps it reminded him of his daddy, as they were the same color as the car that had just flown off without him. "That's beer," I said, hoping to distract him before he started getting emotional again. "Pa says I can't drink it until I got as much hair around my wiener as I got in my head. But since you ain't got none on neither, I reckon it's okay for you." I opened the cooler door, pulled out a can, and cracked it open for him.
"Wiener," said Glubnub,
accepting the can and staring curiously into the open top.
"No," I corrected him, "beer."
He stared at me with his huge black eyes.
"Beer?"
I smiled and nodded. "That's right. You drink it, like this." I pantomimed drinking from an invisible can. He put the can to his lips and tilted his big head back slowly, farther and farther until he'd drunk the entire can. After a long, loud belch, he tossed the empty can on the ground, opened the cooler door, and grabbed another.
"Beer!"
He tried to drink, but the can wasn't open.
"Wait, Glubnub," I said. "You've got to..." "Beer!"
he said, furiously trying to shake beer from the can into his mouth.
"Beer!"
Frustrated by his inability to drink, he hurled the can at the cooler, shattering the glass door.
"Glubnub," I said, "calm down. You've got to open it first."
I picked his can up from the broken glass on the floor and held it in front of him to demonstrate. When I pulled up the tab, beer foam sprayed up like a geyser into his face.
"Quah!"
he shrieked, somehow causing the fluorescent ceiling lights to explode all around the store.
"I'm sorry, Glubnub, that was my fault. Please calm down."
I hurriedly reached for another beer from the cooler, but cut my arm on a jagged edge of the broken glass.
"Shit!" "Shit?"
said Glubnub. "I'm sorry, I shouldn't have used that kind of language. It just slipped out because I hurt myself. See?" I showed him my bleeding forearm. He raised his middle finger at me.
"Shit!"
In spite of my injury, I couldn't help but laugh. "No, Glubnub, that means something different. I probably shouldn't teach you this, but that means fuck you." The tip of Glubnub's finger started glowing red.
"Fuck you."
I stood there paralyzed with awe as he reached over and touched my arm. The wound healed right before my very eyes.
"Thanks, Glubnub,"
I said. Then I cracked open the beer and offered it to him.
"Beer,"
he said excitedly, grabbing the beer out of my hand with both of his. He guzzled down the whole can without even stopping to take a breath. "Looks like we found something you like even more than hot dogs. Do they have beer where you're from?" I pulled a map of my town off a standing rack and unfolded it. "Here's the gas station where we are, and this is Hello Titty over here. That was easily identifiable as the town's most prominent structure. And my house is over here. It ain't marked on the map on account of we tend to move it around a lot. Hopefully Pa won't have moved it again before I have a chance to walk home.
Home?
That's right, Glubnub. Home. I held the map in front of him. Where is your home? Glubnub pointed at the ceiling.
Home.
No, Glubnub, that's just a big mildew stain. I'm asking you about your home. Where are you from? I jostled the map in front of him again to help him understand the question. He pushed the map away and pointed to the beer cooler. I was ready to give up this line of questioning when I saw Coors Light cans float out of the cooler, suspended in the air like they was hanging from invisible strings. One can rotated in place while the other cans began revolving around in increasingly larger circles. Then some spilled M&Ms floated up from the floor and started revolving around the fifth can out from the center, all of them brown except for a single red one. Glubnub pointed up at the red M&M.
Home.
I stared thoughtfully down at the map for a moment, then looked up at the red M&M.
So, where's that? Like, Africa or something?
Africa.
Glubnub let the center can descend down into his hand. He pulled the tab up just like I showed him and started drinking.
Ass police!
Bellowed a loud voice from the entrance.
Come out with your hands up!
The rest of the Coors Light cans fell to the floor simultaneously, and Glubnub looked terrified as he chugged down his third.
Don't worry, I whispered to him. Just stay here and be quiet. I'll go see what they want.
I stepped out from the snack aisle with my hands in the air. Two huge men in black body armor were pointing assault rifles directly at me.
State your name and race,
shouted the one on the left. My name's Dougie Myers. I'm white. Both men breathed a sigh of relief and lowered their weapons.
My name is Agent Freedom, said the one on the right. This is Agent Justice. We are agents of ass.
I don't reckon I'm familiar with ass. I mean, at least in this context.
American shoot Stoffel. We got a report of possible Mexican activity in the area.
Sorry, Mr. Freedom, I don't know nothing about that. Agents Freedom and Justice backed out of the entrance and pointed to Mr. Henry, flattened and bloody just where we'd left him.
Then how do you explain that? Asked Agent Justice. It certainly looks gang-related to me.
Agent Freedom spat out a wad of tobacco spit.
We've got three witnesses who claim to have seen a giant silver sombrero fleeing the scene. So spill your guts, kid. Tell us what you know.
I swear I don't know nothing, I said. The only ones in here are me and my friend Glubnub.
Glubnub, huh? Sure sounds Mexican to me. Stand aside, boy.
Agent Justice stomped past me, and Agent Freedom followed after him.
Wait, I cried. Don't hurt him. He ain't Mexican. He's from Africa.
A chilling thought suddenly occurred to me. Was Africa in Mexico? I was about to chase after them, when I saw Agent Justice slip on a blue puddle expanding from behind the snack aisle. He fell backward into Agent Freedom, and they both hit the floor hard.
Nibmoo!
Glubnub yelled as he ran past them with a Coors Light can in each hand. He continued screaming with terror as he ran out the door. Not knowing what else to do, I ran out behind him. Outside the gas station, a white motorcycle with a sidecar purred with the engine still running. The word ass was painted in bold black letters on either side of it. Glubnub jumped into the sidecar and gestured for me to join him.
Freeze boom!
I didn't remember ever learning such a phrase in school, but somehow I had a strong feeling that frizz boom was foreign for you drive.
I don't know how to drive a motorcycle, I said,
but I hopped onto the main seat just the same. Inside the shop, I saw agents Freedom and Justice scrambling to stand up in Glubnub's pee puddle.
Hey, you two! Get off that bike this instant! You are violating Uncle Sam's ass!
What are we going to do, Glubnub? I asked, frantically pushing all the buttons and dials. But none of them responded to anything I did.
Enough of this, said Agent Freedom, leveling his rifle at us. Let us show these kids what ass tastes like.
I closed my eyes in anticipation of getting shot. The gun sounded like when Pa set off fireworks inside the hornet nest that had formed outside our kitchen window, except these were louder, lasted longer, and surprisingly resulted in a lot less pain. When I opened my eyes again, I couldn't believe what I saw. Not only was I not riddled with bullets, but me and Glubnub was flying more than 50 feet in the air on the ass motorcycle. Below us, the town looked just like the map I'd shown Glubnub at the gas station. Hello Titty stood out as the most recognizable landmark a few miles ahead, and it looked like that's where we were headed. 3. I wasn't sure if either of us were steering. As much as I tried to push the handlebars from side to side, it didn't seem to make much difference. Whatever force was guiding the ass bike seemed to know where it wanted us to go. For a brief but terrifying moment, I wondered if ass had installed some kind of homing device on their motorcycles. Then I reasoned that if that were the case, they'd probably be headed to the police station, which was on the other side of town next to Judd's Tits and Wings, instead of Hello Titty. If it was some kind of ass-inserted device, they still had some bugs to work out. Instead of coming in for a gentle landing on the street out front of Hello Titty, we were heading for a crash landing on the roof.
Hold on, Glubnub, I said. I reckon this is gonna hurt.
Hurt?
Glubnub raised his middle finger at me, the tip of which began glowing red again.
Fuck you.
Boy, did I ever feel like a little bitch, baby. Glubnub was right. Falling out of the sky onto a concrete rooftop wasn't nothing to whine about. Glubnub's family back in Africa probably did stuff like that every day. I'm sorry, I don't mean to complain all the time. I just ain't used to...
Yow!
Cried Glubnub right before we plowed straight into half a dozen barrels of Boner Bob's all-purpose lube. They must have been getting ready to resurface the roof. It was a heck of a landing, and I was surprised to come out of it alive. I'll admit now that it hurt quite a bit, but I wasn't about to say so right after Glubnub called me out for being a bitch baby. Fortunately, Glubnub seemed mostly unharmed as well. He got out of the motorcycle sidecar and staggered around a little before he got his bearings. When he was finally able to stand upright without swaying, he cracked open the Coors Light can he'd brought along for the ride and chugged the whole thing down in one go.
We'd better get out of here, I said when I noticed the growing puddles surrounding the damaged lube barrels.
If they were planning to spread this stuff all over the roof anyway, we might have just saved them the trouble. But I wasn't sure they'd see it that way. Besides, it wouldn't do us any good to get caught next to the stolen ass bike that we'd just wrecked. I grabbed Glubnub by the hand and led him down the stairs that led to the store.
Who the hell are you?
Asked the woman behind the counter. She was big and black, like the kind of women Pa says abuses our welfare system, making it harder for honest white folks like him to pretend to look for a job. Her boobs were big enough to set a tray of food on while she sat down to watch TV. I was in love.
What's the matter with you? She asked. Are you boys retarded?
I snapped out of my daydream of smothering to death between her giant brown breasts.
I'm Dougie, and this is my friend Glubnub.
Are you the ones who made all that noise on the roof just a minute ago?
Yes, ma'am. I admitted, staring down at my feet. The motorcycle we were flying in crash-landed there. I'm sorry.
Don't worry about it. We were just about to have the roof resurfaced anyway. Welcome to Hello Titty. I'm Vonda.
It's a pleasure to meet you, I said, looking up but trying not to stare at her chest. Instead, I stared at a poster on the wall behind her. It was a picture of a woman, her eyes closed and mouth open, kneeling inside a circle of naked men. At the top of the poster, printed in bold white letters, it read, End Racism. At the bottom, in a more stylized font, it read, After all, we're all white when covered in semen. It warmed my heart to see such a progressive message in our town's largest place of business.
That's quite a big dick you're packing, sugar, said Vonda,
suddenly tearing my attention away from the poster.
Huh?
I said, all the blood in my body rushing toward my face and my wiener at once.
Thank you.
Vonda laughed.
I sure as fuck wasn't talking to you, Q-tip. I was talking to your little Mexican friend with the big chimichanga between his legs.
He's actually from Africa, and that's his wiener.
Wiener,
Glubnub confirmed. He waddled up to the counter and stared at a large device in the glass display case. I wasn't sure exactly what it was, but it looked like some kind of power tool used for heavy construction.
That's the Rectal Wrecker 3000, said Vonda, taking it out of the display case and setting it on the counter. Why don't you follow me to the back room and I'll show you how it works?
Can I come too? I asked.
Vonda smiled at me. I'm sorry, but I need someone to stay here and look after the store.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure why exactly, but I felt a little resentful toward Glubnub when the door to the back room closed behind him and Vonda. It wasn't his fault. She chose him over me. No, it was silly to even make that assumption. There was no evidence to suggest that her interest in him went any further than strictly professional. He'd expressed interest in a product she was selling, and it was her job to make the sale. I laughed to myself at how foolish I was being, but those pangs of resentment kept resurfacing while Vonda and Glubnub spent a conspicuously long time in the back room. The muffled noises I heard from the other side of the door sounded like someone trying to fight off a pack of wolves with a lawnmower. In an effort to distract myself, I flipped through a copy of Hustle Horror magazine. It was the semi-annual amputee edition. I didn't think it was fair to call these people disabled, as they were able to accomplish some pretty impressive feats that I could never hope to pull off with all these limbs in the way. Not a single person in the whole magazine was wearing a stitch of clothing. That was probably because most of their tricks involved inserting parts of themselves into parts of other people. But it sure did make my wiener feel strange, and it made me even more resentful of all the attention Vonda was giving to Glubnub. Maybe I was wrong to be so resentful of my new friend's happiness, but it was hardly right for them to expect me to watch over the store all this time while they were in there doing who knows what. When I got to Old Man Cockadoodle's poultry farm advertisement at the back of the magazine, I put it down and resolved to go back there and give them a piece of my mind. But just as I took my first step toward the back door, I noticed something shiny spreading across the floor from the stairs. Oh, no. Pretty soon the whole floor would be covered with Boner Bob's all-purpose lube. I was going to be in so much trouble. I scanned the store for cleaning supplies until I spotted a cooter router up on a shelf behind the counter. The box boasted over a dozen attachments, so I thought the odds were good that one of them might be a mop head or something. Hopping over the counter, I grabbed the box off the shelf and spilled out all of the pieces. Most of them were plastic wieners of varying shapes and sizes, but there was also a fist, a squid, and a giraffe tongue. None of them looked even remotely useful for cleaning gallons and gallons of lube off the floor. That's when I heard the door handle click behind me. Now I wasn't only going to get in trouble for the lube, but also for taking a brand new cooter router out of the box. But when the door opened, only Glubnub was standing there. He was bleary-eyed and smoking a cigarette. Vonda was nowhere to be seen. "Where's Vonda?" I asked nervously. Glubnub took a drag from his cigarette and blew out a long plume of smoke.
"Home."
She must have decided to ditch work through the back door. At first, I was a little annoyed by that. Did she really expect me to hang out here and watch over the store for the rest of the day? She could have at least given me a little training first. What if I couldn't figure out how to work the register? What if someone asked me how many calories were in each flavor of edible underwear? Then, as my gaze fell to the opened cooter rooter on the counter and the Boner Bob's all-purpose lube that was covering nearly the entire floor now, I supposed I kind of owed it to her to just try my best. Maybe this was a good thing. I was learning a trade, after all, and at least I'd have time to clean up the store.
"Hey, you kids!"
boomed a voice as the front doorbell jingled. It was Agent Freedom. He looked even angrier than before, no doubt due in part to the nasty bump on his head he must have gotten when he slipped in Glubnub's pee at the gas station. Glubnub held up his glowing middle finger.
"Fuck you."
"Glubnub," I said, wishing I'd never taught him that phrase. Needless to say, Agent Freedom didn't take kindly to the gesture.
"Why, you little punks, I'll kick your grassy asses."
He and Agent Justice rushed toward us, slipped on the expanding puddle of Boner Bob's all-purpose lube, and slid across the floor until they smashed through the glass display case under the counter. A bunch of brightly colored plastic sausages fell down on their heads. "Come on, Glubnub," I said, taking his hand. "We've got to get out of here." I pulled him around the counter so forcefully that he dropped his cigarette. We were lucky to get out of there when we did, because the whole place went up in flames as soon as we bolted out the door. When we were safely across the street, I stopped to take in all that had just happened. I felt bad about Vonda's sudden unemployment, but I was happy that she'd made it out before the fire started. It felt kind of selfish to think along these lines, but I was sort of extra lucky the fire happened when it did. I was off the hook for spilling Boner Bob's all-purpose lube all over the floor and for opening that cooter rooter, and nobody would ever know I'd done it. On the other hand, I regretted not taking that Hustle Horror magazine with me, and there was still the matter of... Oh, no! I'd totally forgotten about Agent Freedom and Agent Justice trapped inside a burning building.
"Ah!"
cried Agent Freedom from inside the store.
"You!"
screamed Agent Justice. I breathed a sigh of relief. They were alive. "Come on, Glubnub," I said. "Let's go home. I'll introduce you to my pa."
Home.
4. It was getting pretty late in the evening by the time we got to Itchy Johnson's mobile home community. "That's our house, just up there," I said, proudly pointing to one of only 5 trailers on our street that hadn't yet succumbed to a meth lab fire. "Try not to say anything in foreign. Pa's still sore about my birth mama leaving him for some guy who ain't even related to us."
"Home."
"That's right. This is where I live." I pulled out the stick we wedged under the door to keep it shut, then let Glubnub inside. Pa hurriedly yanked his hand out from the front of his pants and hurled his half-drunk beer can at the VCR. His aim was high, sending the beer can smashing through the living room window, so I pushed the stop button, cutting short his favorite Holocaust documentary.
"Where the fuck you been, Dougie?"
he asked, cracking open a fresh beer and covering his crotch with a throw pillow.
"Your mama's been worried sick about you."
"I was at the gas station where you left me. Did you say mama?"
"Is that you, Dougie?"
called a female voice from Pa's bedroom. It sounded familiar, but not like any of the mamas I could remember. My cousin, Wendy Peters, walked into the room, 8 months pregnant if she was a day. She was wearing one of my third mama's maternity dresses with a skirt that went all the way down to the floor. It was a lot different than the dresses she usually wore to school, which were short enough to show off her cooter every time she bent over.
"There you are."
She smiled at me, then leaned over the couch to lick Pa's face the way he likes. "You already done watching Goebbels Gone Wild?"
"I reckon so," Pa said with a sigh. "A man can't get a minute of privacy in his own goddamn house, it seems."
"Wendy's my mama now?" I asked, a little hurt on account of I'd always hoped I'd get to marry her someday. "When did y'all get married?"
Pa chuckled to himself. "It weren't so fancy and formal as all that. Wendy here needed a place to squat until she shits out another kid, and I needed a hole to squirt my sperm into. Everybody's a winner."
"Wiener," said Glubnub.
Wendy smiled at him as her gaze fell to his massive gray dong. "That is quite a wiener. Who's your friend, Dougie?" "This is Glubnub."
"What the fuck kind of name is Glubnub?"
asked Pa, rubbing his stubbled chin thoughtfully.
"Is he Mexican?"
Glubnub waddled toward Pa with his glowing middle finger raised.
"Fuck you."
"Glubnub," I said. "Sorry, Pa. He's just a little sensitive about his ethnicity. He's from Africa."
"Fucker's got a mouth on him, don't he?"
Dad shifted on the couch, visibly uncomfortable, as Glubnub stared closely at his right foot.
"What's he doing, Dougie?" "He's starting to freak me the fuck out."
Glubnub touched his glowing fingertip to the side of Pa's foot.
"Fuck you."
"What in the Jesus Christ?"
Pa gaped in horror at his own foot, which now had one more toe than it had just a moment ago.
"Wow," I said. "I thought all you could do is heal people. I didn't know you could grow extra body parts. I've always wanted another arm, but on my back. Could you do that, or does it just work with toes?"
"This ain't an extra toe," said Pa, sounding more annoyed than awestruck. "I was born with 6 toes on my right foot. My mama had it surgically removed as a high school graduation gift when I was 26 years old. And now look at it."
He sighed and shook his head.
"All those years of education wasted."
"Don't be so dramatic," said Wendy. "There's a hobo behind the quick fix who will bite that off for you if you watch him piss on a dead raccoon. My daddy had his done just the other day."
She took Glubnub by the hand and smiled at him in a way that made my wiener feel like it did when I was looking at all them naked amputees in Hustle Whore magazine.
"I could use some healing too, Glubnub. I think I just came down with a case of ovarian cancer."
"Fuck you."
"Let's get that arm up in there first and see where that leads."
When the bedroom door closed behind Wendy and Glubnub, I started getting those resentful feelings in my head and that tingly feeling in my wiener. Fortunately, Pa was with me this time. Maybe he could shed some light on these strange feelings I was having.
"Pa, can I ask you a question?"
"Not now, shit for brains. Ain't you heard what your mama said? I got to go down to the quick fix and get this toe bit off. I might swing by Judd's tits and wings on my way back if I don't lose too much blood, so don't wait up."
He walked out the front door, and I was once again alone with my thoughts. First Vonda, now Wendy. Why was it that all the girls liked Glubnub so much, but didn't even seem to notice me at all? What was so special about him? So what if I didn't have black eyes the size of softballs or a wiener like an elephant's trunk or magical glowing fingers? There was plenty about me that was special if a girl were to take the time to look at who I was on the inside. I'd once gotten a C+ on a spelling test. Pa was so proud he pinned it on the bathroom wall over the toilet. He took it down a week later when we ran out of toilet paper, but that didn't erase the fact that it happened. Had Glubnub ever gotten a C+ on a spelling test? Not likely, considering he only seemed to know about half a dozen words in English. But I suppose a higher education don't mean so much to girls as a 14-inch...
Ah!
Cried Wendy from Pa's bedroom.
Before I had time to react, the door swung open. Much to my surprise, it wasn't Wendy or Glubnub who came running out first.
Vonda? I said, hardly able to believe that she was here in my living room and curious as to why she was covered in yellow slime. She wiped some slime from her face and opened her eyes. Her confused gaze darted back and forth around the room.
Where am I? She asked. How did I get here?
You're in my house, I said. Don't you remember me? She shook her head.
Sorry, kid, but don't feel bad. Your face is pretty forgettable.
I was in Hello Titty earlier today with my friend Glubnub.
That hot Mexican boy?
He's African.
Oh, yeah, I remember you. Aren't you supposed to be looking after the store? What are you doing here?
I live here, I said, just a touch annoyed.
What are you doing here?
I'm not sure. The last thing I remember was demonstrating the rectal wrecker 3000 to your friend. Seeing as how it was his first time, I thought I'd go easy on him and use the zucchini attachment. But his butthole took in the whole device, along with my arm and, well, I suppose the rest of me.
You've been up in Glubnub's butthole this whole time?
Vonda shrugged.
I guess I have. Anyway, I'd better get back to Hello Titty. That new line of cooter rooters ain't gonna sell themselves.
Actually, you might want to... Why bother warning her? She was already out the door, and she was going to find out for herself soon enough that the store had burned to the ground. Besides, I had more pressing concerns to deal with.
5.
Home, said Glubnub, waddling into the living room with a brand new rectal wrecker 3000 in his hands.
Wendy came out after him, and she sure didn't look happy.
What's wrong? I asked. What happened in there?
I'll tell you what happened. I tried to put your friend's dick in my mouth, and he totally freaked and shot out a black woman. I mean, what if I'd been eating his ass at the time?
I wasn't sure how to answer that.
I reckon that would probably hurt.
Hurt?
Hurt, said Glubnub, waddling toward Wendy with his middle finger glowing. Fuck you,
Wendy scoffed.
You had your chance for that. Maybe you'll think next time before you...
Her face scrunched up like she'd just sucked on a lemon or walked in on Pa taking a shit.
Wendy, I said, are you okay?
She nodded.
It ain't nothing. I just need to fart is all.
After a few seconds, she let out a fart that even Pa would have been impressed by. It was loud and wet and followed by a gush of rusty brown liquid that expanded out from under her dress.
How embarrassing. I think I just shat myself.
Would you like me to fetch you some toilet paper? I really hoped we had some. This might be my big chance to be Wendy's knight in shining armor.
Wendy opened her mouth to say something, but whatever she wanted to say came out as a high-pitched scream. She looked as confused by the sound as I was. Lifting her dress, she revealed the true source of the strange noise. A plump little baby lay on the floor between her feet in a puddle of gore, screaming his slimy purple head off.
Thank the Lord, said Wendy. I didn't shit myself after all.
Congratulations, I said, intending it more about having the baby than for the fact that she hadn't shit herself, but she could take it however made her feel best.
What are you going to name him? Wendy picked up the baby off the floor, bit off a chunk of umbilical cord, and spat it out on the floor. I'll let his daddy decide that. Who's his daddy? I ain't exactly sure, but I think I got it narrowed down to a couple of dozen likely candidates. I'm going to head down to Judd's Tits and Wings to collect some semen samples. My friend Skeeter works at the crime lab. He can compare the DNA in the samples to this little crotch goblin. Wow, I said. I didn't realize you knew so much about science. I watch a lot of crime shows when I'm volunteering at Happy Endings. Some of those old folks have trouble maintaining an erection, so it can take forever to get them to shoot a load. Sometimes they'll nod off to sleep while I'm tugging on their noodle. At least you're getting an education. I spent 45 minutes watching CSI Miami while I polished Mr. Argyle's pole last week, and he was hard as a rock. Oh? I kind of wanted her to leave now before she saw how hard I was getting. As it turned out, that was on account of he was dead, but it was nice to see an episode all the way through to the end without any interruptions. I can imagine. Wendy gazed down at the baby in her arms. Well, I guess I'd better run and collect some samples before everyone's too drunk to squirt them out. Mind if I borrow that bucket? She gestured to the red plastic pail we used to catch water dripping from the leak in the ceiling. Given how much afterbirth and amniotic fluid there was on the floor, a little water dripping down on it was probably a good thing. Sure, I said, grabbing the throw pillow to hide my crotch while I picked up the bucket. Thanks, Dougie. You know, I thought it might be weird being your mama, given that we both go to the same school and all, but I'm starting to think we got a good mother-son dynamic going on now. Yeah, that's just what I was thinking, I said, trying to pretend that holding a throw pillow against my crotch was the most natural thing in the world. When she finally left, I dropped the pillow and turned to Glubnub. He was still holding the rectal wrecker 3000, but he'd switched the zucchini attachment out for the pointing finger. Did you pay for that? I asked him sternly.
Pay,
Glubnub responded. That's right, pay. You can't just go around taking whatever you want. You got to pay money for that. Do you have money? Glubnub squeezed the trigger on the rectal wrecker 3000, and the plastic hand on the other end started oscillating, its pointing finger repeatedly jabbing the air in front of it.
Home.
You got money at home? Then you'd better go home and get it, or else we got to go back to Hello Titty and come clean to Miss Vonda about what you...
Ass raid!
Shouted a familiar voice from the front door.
Nobody move!
I turned around to find Agent Freedom and Agent Justice standing angrily in my doorway. Their clothes were scorched, and their skin was all covered in second and third degree burns.
Put down the weapon, said Agent Justice.
I stood there frozen, not knowing what he was talking about, until Agent Freedom spoke up.
That ain't no weapon, Stan. That's a rectal wrecker 3000.
He squinted at me.
Did this Mexican penetrate you with that device, son?
Look at that tent he's pitching, said Agent Justice. He was totally into it. These two are a couple of queers. Glubnub raised his glowing middle finger.
Fuck you.
You pole-smoking son of a bitch, said Agent Freedom. Get them!
The two ass agents lunged toward us, slipped on the puddle of afterbirth Wendy had left on the floor, and slammed face first into the opposite wall.
Come on, Glubnub, I said. Let's get out of here.
I grabbed his hand and led him out of the trailer, not having any idea where to go. Where else was there left to run now that ass knew where I lived? We only made it as far as the end of the driveway when a black car screeched to a halt in front of us. The tinted passenger side front window slid down, revealing a white-haired man wearing a black suit and dark sunglasses.
Get in the car if you don't want to die.
Being immortal sounded pretty cool, so I opened the door. The man pulled it shut again.
In the back, idiot.
I'm sorry, I said, Last time I got into a stranger's car, he wanted me to sit on his lap.
Just get in the fucking car before those agents come to.
I opened the back door and guided Glubnub into the back seat. As soon as I closed the door behind me, the car sped away. The driver was a younger man with long hair and a grizzled beard. He smelled like cigarettes and whiskey and was dressed a lot less fancy than the man who told us to get in the car. "Who are you guys?" I asked. The older man turned around and gazed at us with icy blue eyes over his sunglasses.
"My name is Murphy. This is Dick."
"Do you work for ass?" Murphy sighed.
"Indirectly."
"How's that?"
"I work for money, and then I spend a large portion of that money on hookers. So, yes, if you were the judging type, you could say that I work for ass. But frankly, I don't see how that's any of your business, you nosy little shit."
"I was referring to the government agency American Schutzstaffel."
"Oh, you mean ass?"
"Yes, sir."
"We don't work for them. We work for the United States government."
"But those guys said ass was a government agency."
"Former agency," Murphy corrected me. "They've gone rogue, and we might be the only ones who can stop them."
"How are you going to do that?" I asked.
"By getting a man inside ass. Once we do that, our member can deliver a load that will utterly destroy it."
"That sounds hard."
"You're goddamn right it's hard, harder than a priest with an Oshkosh catalog. My dick's been trying to penetrate ass for years, but to no avail. Every time we think we've found the way in, it turns out to be full of shit."
"So what do you want from me and Glubnub?" I asked.
"If they won't open ass to dick, then maybe a child could slide in unnoticed to release a load."
"A load of what? Explosives?"
"At best, that would only destroy one cell. I mean to wipe every asshole in the country."
"So, like, some sort of biological warfare?" Dick chuckled.
"It's far more insidious than that. What do you say, boys? Do you want to help me wipe assholes?"
I shrugged. "That sounds nice, but those ass agents have been chasing us all over town on account of they think Glubnub here is a Mexican. They'll recognize us for sure."
"Not if you're wearing a disguise."
Murphy reached into his jacket and pulled out two pairs of black-rimmed glasses. Each of them included a fake nose and mustache.
"Whoa!" I said as I accepted the glasses and handed a pair to Glubnub. "These are amazing!"
I tried mine on, and Glubnub followed my lead. His eyes were too big and far apart to wear them properly, so he put them on over his nostril slits instead. The color of the fake nose didn't match his gray skin, but that was one of those little details nobody was going to notice unless they were specifically looking for it.
"How do we look?" I asked.
Dick squinted at us in the rearview mirror.
"Perfect. You look like an entirely different person, and I'd never guess that your friend was a Mexican."
"Actually, he's..."
"Here's the package," said Murphy,
pushing a turquoise duffel bag at me between the front seats. It was too heavy to be gym clothes, but not quite heavy enough to be a dead hooker. "What's in here?" I asked.
"Mind your own goddamn business."
He reached into his jacket again and pulled out a cell phone.
"After you make the drop, get the hell out of there and call me with this phone."
"Phone,"
said Glubnub, reaching out eagerly to accept it. "Do you have phones in Africa?" I asked.
"Home."
6. Dick dropped us off in front of a place called Bucky's Bibles and Bullets. It was a quaint little shop that I must have passed 100 times before without ever noticing it was there.
"One of our sources said this place is a front for an asshole," said Murphy.
"What should I say when we go in there?" I asked.
"You'll have to be subtle. If you ask about getting into ass right away, they might get spooked and clench up. Let the conversation get there naturally. Good luck."
They tore off down the road, leaving me and Glubnub in a cloud of exhaust. "What do you think, Glubnub?" He stared at me with his huge, unblinking black eyes. good thinking. We'll go in there and make ourselves at home. Like us being there is the most natural thing in the world. I opened the door for Glubnub and followed him inside. It was a small shop with a giant Confederate flag rug on the floor, and the walls were covered in handguns, rifles, grenade launchers, and a whole bunch of other weaponry I couldn't even identify. There was a small bookshelf near the entrance that must have been the shop's Bible section. The Bibles on it had nice fancy leather covers, but they looked like someone had gone and tore all the pages out. Not one of them looked to have more than a single sheet of paper between the front and back covers. I hoped we wouldn't have to buy anything to prove ourselves. All the guns on the wall were way beyond the credit limits of any of the stolen cards Pa had given me to eat lunch with. The only thing I could afford was in the bargain bin, which was made of four scraps of particle board held together by a length of twine wrapped around them. The sign on it advertised, "Defective hand grenades, 4 for $1.
"My name's Bucky," said the large bearded man in a sleeveless flannel shirt behind the counter. "How can I help you boys?"
"What's wrong with these hand grenades?" I asked. Bucky shrugged.
"Some of them just don't work. Others got loose pins, faulty fuses, or other such defects that compromise their stability. All I know is that I buy them off the government 3 for $1 and sell them 4 for $1, and I keep the difference."
He gave me a wink and a yellow-toothed grin, clearly proud of his business savvy. "Why's all these Bibles so skinny?" I asked, seeking to further sell my interest in his store. "I always thought they was thicker."
"Them's the abridged version. We cut out all the bullshit and only kept the most important parts of God's word, like the part about how you ain't supposed to be a queer and the Second Amendment."
I figured that was probably enough small talk. Now it was time to ease my way into the real reason we were there.
"I sure do like ass."
Bucky turned his head and spat out a gob of something brown.
"Is that right?"
He bent over, then came back up with a bucket of Boner Bob's all-purpose lube, which he set down on the counter.
"Do either of you boys have genital herpes?"
"I don't think so."
"Well, then you're in luck. I think you're really going to enjoy it."
"Is that something you give to all new agents?"
"Agents?"
Bucky scratched his sweaty armpit thoughtfully for a moment, until his eyes suddenly widened.
"Hang on a second. Was you talking about ass?"
"Yes, sir."
"You got to be clearer, son. That was just about to get really awkward."
"I'm sorry." Bucky walked past us and turned the sign on the door from open to closed. He locked the door, then turned to face us.
"So you boys want to get into my asshole?"
I nodded.
"That's right."
"Well, you seem wide enough, and we have been aiming to get younger members in ass, but you got to take a test to prove yourselves ass-worthy."
That made me a little nervous. I didn't know there was going to be a test.
"Maybe we should come back later. Is there something we can study?"
Bucky pulled a gun out from the front of his pants.
"It ain't hard. Just one simple question."
I glanced at Glubnub. His glasses were fogged up from being over his nostrils, but he didn't seem nervous at all. I wished I had his confidence, but the best I could do right now was to fake it.
"Go ahead," I said. "Ask your question. We ain't afraid."
"All right, then," said Bucky. "On a scale of 1 to 10, what's the greatest country in the world?"
That was a tough one, but I couldn't spend too long thinking about it or he'd know I was just guessing.
6?
Bucky pointed his gun at my face and pulled back the hammer.
"Guess again."
4?
"A little higher."
9?
"That's too high."
11?
"It's 5.
5?
Bucky lowered his gun.
"All right, you're in. I would have also accepted America.
As it turned out, the big Confederate flag rug on the floor was there for more than just decoration. Bucky rolled it back to reveal that it had been covering a sheet of plywood, which was in turn covering the entrance to a secret underground bunker.
Whoa, I said. This place is the real deal.
You're goddamn right it is, said Bucky. Come on down and meet your brothers in arms.
The stairs he led us down looked to have been carved out of the bare earth with shovels. Going a bit farther down, the whole bunker appeared to have been constructed the same way. There weren't any support beams or concrete or nothing. We were essentially just walking in a giant hole in the ground. Are you sure this place is safe? I asked.
Sure it's safe. Ain't no place safer in the whole goddamn world.
You ain't worried about it caving in on top of you? Bucky laughed.
You sound like one of them fucking OSHA pussies. Let me tell you something, boy. The day you sacrifice a little bit of personal liberty to let some pencil-pushing government geek tell you how to live your life, you might as well bend over and let Satan fuck you in the asshole. Do you like the sound of that?
No, sir.
Well, them's your only two choices. Freedom or getting cornholed by Satan. So what's it gonna be?
When he put it like that, the answer was pretty clear. Freedom, I reckon.
Too goddamn right.
Bucky stepped aside now that we'd reached the bottom of the tunnel where it opened up to a chamber about the size of our trailer. Three men sat on wooden crates along the earthen walls, eating beans straight out of the cans, while a fourth man squatted in the middle of the room, taking a dump on the floor.
This is Dallas, Boone, Leland, and Shitter.
You call him that because he likes to poo on the floor?
Nah, that's the name his mama gave him. We all shit on the floor. It's good fertilizer, and we're trying to grow grass down here to make like a carpet. You know, class up the joint a little.
Who the fuck is they?
Asked Boone, staring at me with his one functioning eye like he could see right through my disguise.
These boys are our newest members, said Bucky.
He looked like he was about to continue when he stopped short and gave me a curious look.
He'd seen through my disguise, too. We were done for.
I don't believe I caught your names, he said.
Oh, I tried to think up some fake names fast to throw them off our scent.
I'm Glubnub, and this is Dougie.
Glubnub, said Boone. What are you, some kind of Mexican?
Of course not, I said, forcing out a chuckle. That's French for, white power.
Oh, I stand corrected. French, huh? That's pretty fancy.
My mama's part French, said Leland.
Boone shot him a glare.
Bullshit. Which part?
Her armpits. She ain't shaved them in years.
Well, I'll be damned.
Glubnub and I had successfully penetrated an asshole. Now it was time to deliver our load. Every second we remained down here, we risked blowing the whole mission.
I brought y'all a gift, I said, lugging the duffel bag Murphy had given me around Shitter to the other side of the room.
I set it down between Dallas and Boone.
That's awful nice of you, said Dallas, lifting it up an inch off the ground. It's too heavy to be sweaty gym clothes, but it ain't heavy enough to be a dead hooker. What is it?
I backed away, trying not to give away my nervousness.
Why don't you open it up and find out?
Boone unzipped it, and a wide grin spread across his face.
Hustle whore!
Hustle whore? As in the magazine? That couldn't have been how Murphy meant to take down ass. That didn't seem very insidious at all. But sure enough, I recognized the cover as soon as Boone pulled it out. It was the same issue I'd been perusing at Hello Titty while Glubnub was in the back room sucking Vonda up into his butthole.
Is that the semi-annual amputee edition? Asked Shitter.
His pants still around his ankles, he hopped over to the others and pulled another magazine out of the bag.
It was another copy of the same issue as the one Boone had pulled out.
There's got to be 100 of these in here. We can line the walls of our asshole with titty pics.
Now wait just a goddamn minute, said Boone.
The grin vanished from his face as he stared in confusion at the open magazine he was holding.
This ain't titty pics. What the fuck is this?
Some kind of witchcraft, said Dallas, looking over his shoulder. Arcane symbols and shit.
Boone held the open magazine toward me.
What's the meaning of this, boy?
Looking at the magazine, I was just as surprised as they were. Maybe I hadn't flipped far enough through it at Hello Titty, but I didn't remember any introductory phonics lessons. That's a picture of an apple, I said.
I know what an apple is, motherfucker. I mean the thing next to it, like a triangle with little legs.
That's the letter A. It makes a sound like the beginning of the word apple. Boone held the magazine up to his ear and listened intently for a moment.
Like fuck it does.
It's a symbol, I explained. It tells you what sound you're supposed to make to form words.
Bullshit, said Bucky. The day I sacrifice a little bit of liberty to let some symbol tell me what sound to make is the day I let Satan fuck me in the asshole.
Now wait just a minute, Bucky, said Shitter. A code like this just might come in handy. We could use it to pass secret messages across enemy lines and such.
Dallas coughed up a gob of brown phlegm and spat it on the floor.
You might be onto something. Let me take another look at that.
What's going on here?
Bellowed Agent Justice as he and Agent Freedom stomped into the asshole. They were still burned and bleeding all over, but now they were covered in the asbestos powder that falls down from our ceiling whenever anything bumps against the walls of our trailer too hard.
What's that you're looking at?
I noticed Glubnub's middle finger starting to glow, so I forced his hand down and shushed him before he could mouth off to them again. Boone held up his modified Hustle Whore magazine.
It's instructions to a secret code! You goddamn morons!
Agent Freedom tore the magazine out of Boone's hand and threw it on the ground.
Don't you know what this is? This is instructions on how to read!
The four men gasped. Agent Justice grabbed Boone under each pit stain of his undershirt.
You know what reading leads to, don't you?
Boone shook his head.
No, don't say it. That's right. Independent thought. No! Where'd you get these fake titty mags?
The new boys brought them.
New boys? Said Agent Freedom. What new boys?
Boone raised a trembling finger toward us.
Them over there.
Just as Agents Freedom and Justice turned around to look at us, the scents of poo, sweat, chewing tobacco, and scorched ass combined to tickle my nose in such a way as to make me sneeze the disguise right off my face.
Achoo!
Hey, said Agent Justice. Ain't that the boy we caught aiding and abetting that Mexican? But where is the Mexican?
Agent Freedom wondered aloud.
Let's get him! We'll beat it out of him!
They ran at us, but slipped in Shitter's poo puddle, slamming into the wall as I pulled Glubnub out of the way.
Come on, Glubnub! I said. Our cover's blown!
We ran up the earthen stairs as fast as we could. When we emerged from the asshole, I was prepared to keep on running, but Glubnub stopped at the bargain bin.
What are you doing? I asked. We ain't got time for shopping!
He responded. He must have wanted to take a souvenir of his trip back to Africa, and I supposed he wasn't going to find no better deal than hand grenades at 4 for $1. But then I noticed he wasn't even taking the grenades. He was only taking the twine that was holding the bin together.
Don't y'all got string in Africa?
I asked. Then I felt bad about taking for granted all the freedom and string this great country has to offer.
Zip frabble bum bum, said Glubnub as he finally got the twine free from the bin.
The bin fell apart, and all the grenades spilled down into the asshole.
You gone and done it now, Glubnub, I said, like they ain't mad enough already.
Home,
was all Glubnub had to say in response as he took his ill-gotten wares and headed out the door. I left a dollar on the counter, which I thought was fair since he took the twine, but only a small piece of each grenade.
Oh, shit!
I heard Boone call out from down in the asshole before I followed Glubnub out the front door. A sound like a quick series of explosions shook the ground under my feet, and when I looked back inside the shop, I saw the whole floor had caved in. Glubnub and I were lucky to have gotten out of there when we did. I considered going back in to dig them out, thinking that might go some ways toward us setting aside our differences, whatever those might be. But then I saw Glubnub still waddling away, half a block up the street. He was a foreigner in a strange land and was depending on me to look after him. Paralyzed with indecision, I stopped to ask myself what Jesus would do.
I'd go with Glubnub, said a brown-skinned man staggering by with a large wooden cross over his shoulder. He's way more fun than those shitheads.
He nodded toward the entrance to Bucky's Bullets and Bibles. Blood dripped down his face, probably caused by the thorns he had wrapped around the top of his head. Who are you? I asked. The strange man smiled gently at me.
I am who I am.
Popeye? His smile disappeared, replaced with an expression of mild annoyance.
Listen, kid, I've got places to be. They've got a BOGO deal on filet-of-fish sandwiches at McDonald's today. Glubnub needs your help. Oh, I almost forgot.
He reached into a gaping wound in his side, then pulled out a hammer.
He also needs this.
What about you?
I'm a carpenter. I've got plenty more at home.
I took the hammer from his hand, which I noticed had a large hole in the middle of it.
Thanks, mister. Don't mention it. Go in peace.
All this guy's open wounds were starting to freak me out. My decision was based less on his advice and more on wanting to get away from him. I thanked him one more time for the hammer, then ran off after Glubnub.
7. When I finally caught up with Glubnub, he was messing around with the rectal wrecker 3000 next to a red pickup truck.
What are you doing? I asked when I finally caught my breath. I held up the hammer. Some guy said you need this.
Glubnub ignored the hammer, his concentration focused on swapping out the finger attachment on the end of the rectal wrecker 3000 for a long and slender attachment. When he was done, he inserted the device into the keyhole of the driver's side door and pulled the trigger. After a bit of scraping and screeching, I saw the lock pop up through the window. Glubnub opened the door.
Glubnub.
It seemed like an awful big coincidence, him having a truck that was parked here, but he did appear to have a working key, so I supposed I couldn't argue with that. He crawled over to the passenger seat and motioned for me to get in. I got into the driver's seat and closed the door, unsure of what I was supposed to do after that.
Mung boomba flug,
said Glubnub, a little irritably.
I don't have a key, I responded.
Glubnub's middle finger glowed red as he touched the ignition.
Fuck you.
The truck's engine roared to life, which surprised me. This truck looked even older than Paws. I didn't expect it to be equipped with this fancy keyless ignition technology, and that wasn't the only surprising sound I heard.
Pow! Pow!
It sounded a lot like gunshots. I checked the side mirror to see if I could figure out what was making the sound, but it exploded into a million shards as soon as I looked at it. Checking the rear view, I spotted Agents Freedom and Justice staggering toward us, guns in hand and even more burnt, bloody, and ticked off than before.
Pow! Pow!
They fired off a couple more shots, causing the rear windshield to explode.
Mung bumba flug, said Glubnub.
I don't know how to drive, I confessed, realizing that I probably should have brought that up when I told him I didn't have a key.
Glubnub sighed. Then the truck lifted off the ground. Agents Freedom and Justice fired off a few more shots, putting some holes in the floor of the truck as we flew away over the woods toward Judd's tits and wings. Fortunately, they didn't put any holes in me or Glubnub. When the shooting finally stopped, I sighed with relief. We were finally in the clear. At least, that's what I thought, until the truck's engine cut off.
Skag flubbavim, said Glubnub.
I checked the gas gauge. The needle was on E.
We're out of gas,
I said as the truck started to plummet. Fortunately, Judd's tits and wings was there to break our fall, and we were no worse for the wear when the dust cleared and we found ourselves on a stage next to a shiny steel pole.
You landed on Darlene,
said a man with a red hat sitting at a table with his wiener in his hand.
I want my dollar back.
Damn it, Dougie,
said Paw, sitting at a different table but also holding his wiener.
What did I tell you about killing strippers?
I thought about it for a moment, but couldn't quite remember. Not wanting to disappoint him, I gave it my best guess. Always ask for a receipt?
That's for rectal exams, you dumb shit.
That's solid advice, said the man in the red hat. Proves you ain't queer.
So what was the one about killing strippers? I asked.
You wait until everyone's finished jacking off.
Your daddy's right, said the man in the red hat. That's just common courtesy.
Glubnub and I got out of the truck. The crushed woman underneath was completely naked. We must have knocked the clothes right off her.
I'm real sorry, Paul, I said. I'll try to be more considerate from now on.
Sorry ain't gonna cut it. These folks came to see a show, so I reckon you'd better strip down and whack off that Mexican friend of yours.
Huh?
I wasn't sure I'd heard that right. You want me to...
Quit your yapping, said the man in the red hat. Take off your clothes and tug that tamale like your daddy told you.
Fuck you,
said Glubnub.
The fuck you say?
The man in the red hat stood up and pointed at Glubnub with the hand that wasn't still holding his wiener.
This is America, son, and that kind of language is offensive here.
But Glubnub wasn't paying attention to him. He'd been talking to the dead woman under the truck, who he was now poking with his glowing middle finger.
Glubnub, I whispered, this ain't Africa. Here it's considered rude to poke dead people when they ain't wearing no clothes. We're already in enough trouble for landing your truck on...
Ah!
Shouted the dead woman.
Ah!
I shouted back in response.
Where am I? What happened? Why am I under a truck?
She grabbed the pole, pulled herself out from under the truck, and looked up at me.
Who the fuck are you?
My name's Dougie. I accidentally landed a truck on you. Sorry about that. She shrugged.
It happens. Occupational hazard.
But you're okay now. My friend brought you back from the dead.
Back from the dead? What is he, Mexican?
No, he's... Dougie? Said a familiar voice from near the front of the restaurant.
Is that you?
Wendy? I peered through the lingering cigarette smoke and found Wendy at a table near the entrance. She was sitting at a table with her baby in one arm and tugging on a man's wiener with her other hand.
Come on now, you got to start calling me Mama.
Yes, said the man at her table, leaning back in his chair. Stroke it, Mama. Now call me your little bitch baby.
Wait, no, too late. Mr. Ferguson!
Wendy let go of his wiener and picked up the red plastic bucket I'd loaned her.
You were supposed to go on the bucket. Now I'm going to need another sample from you.
She held up the bucket and smiled at me.
Look, Dougie, I'm almost finished collecting my samples to bring to the lab.
The bucket was 3/4 full of something that looked like spoiled milk. I smiled back politely.
That's nice.
Then a thought occurred to me. But if they're all mixed up like that, how are you going to be able to tell whose is whose? Wendy's smile faded as she considered my question. Ah, fuck, she finally said. Now I'm going to have to start from the beginning. She dumped the bucket out on the floor. I ain't going to make it home in time for America's Most Shameless Whores Do Anything to be on TV.
I'll record it for you, said Pa. If you want another sample from me, you'd best get to it. I got to go home and snort some bleach to stave off the rabies from the hobo who bit my toe off.
Okay, just give me a minute to rinse out the bucket and...
Everybody freeze!
Boomed Agent Freedom as he kicked in the door.
This is an ass raid!
He and Agent Justice stood silhouetted against the sliver of evening sky cutting through the smoky dimness of the restaurant. For a second, I thought they might not spot us right away through the haze of cigarette smoke.
There he is,
shouted Agent Justice, pointing directly at Glubnub.
Get him!
They charged toward us, but slipped in the puddle of DNA samples Wendy had spilled on the floor. We had to get out of there, and we didn't have much time. Do you have a back door? I asked the naked woman I'd crushed with Glubnub's truck.
Sure, kid. Everyone does. But if you want to put your dick in mine, it's going to cost you extra.
Boys,
said a man sitting at a table on the other side of the stage from where Pa and the man in the red hat were sitting. He was wearing a long white dress, which he had hiked up in front so he could hold his wiener.
Come quickly. I will help you escape.
Now that I got a better look at him, I recognized him as the priest who had recently been transferred here from his diocese in Chicago because the other priests couldn't compete with his high molestation rates. Father O'Toole, I said, what are you doing here?
I'm here for the wings, nothing more. But there's not time to discuss that. We must hurry. Follow me.
I grabbed Glubnub by the arm and ran after Father O'Toole toward the back of the restaurant, then through the building's rear exit. He led us through the parking lot toward a white windowless van with the words Free Absolutions spray-painted in black on the side. I didn't know what absolutions meant, but I figured it must be a fancy word for bananas. When he opened the van's rear doors, I saw bunches and bunches of bananas in varying stages of ripening, ranging from firm and green to mushy and black, lying all over the place.
Get in, my sons. Those men may not enjoy reveling in a puddle of semen for as long as I do.
Who could say no to free bananas? I climbed up into the van and helped Glubnub in after me. 8. When I'd eaten as many bananas as my stomach could hold, it occurred to me that I had no idea where Father O'Toole was taking us. Hey, Father, I said through the mesh barrier separating the back of the van from the driver's seat. Where are we going?
To a special place, he answered. Do not worry, my child. I think you will like it. I hear no complaints from any of the other children I've interred there.
Interred? Father O'Toole laughed nervously.
Did I say interred? I meant to say entered.
That was a relief. For a second, I thought he was speaking in foreign. It was nice to know there would be other kids there. Maybe I'd make some friends. But just when
I... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.